It must be very difficult for you, and really you have my sympathy, because you see printed piano and I'm asking you to do something different. Then another conductor comes and he says, exactly what's printed? I don't know, I'm not speaking personally, but I imagine this happens to you sometimes. So forgive me, but I'm trying to find the spirit of the music, what it feels like. Let's start. Together. Shh, shh. Quiet, please. Quiet.
For more than half a century, the name Leopold Stokowski has meant glamour and magic in the art of symphonic music. Today, at the age of 88, Stokowski still leads his own orchestra and still ranks as one of the most remarkable old men the world of music has ever known. Stokowski never thinks of retirement. Probably he never will. Too many of the world's finest orchestras continue to want him for guest appearances. Stokowski continues to make recordings each year. He is still master of the old and champion of the new, and still doing what he himself describes as his favorite occupation. Sweating it out with 100 other musicians at rehearsal.
The great necessity in a symphonic orchestra is cooperation, that we work together.
It's too loud.
We call it by other names, but it really is cooperation. And we like to make the music alone in a rehearsal. Personally, I prefer the rehearsals to the concerts, because there is, in the rehearsal, the possibility to try again, do better and better certain moments.
We don't hear your second note. Don't make any diminuendo, because it goes down in the low. We don't hear it. B!
This is the American Symphony Orchestra, established by Stokowski in 1962. Many members of the orchestra are auditioned by Stokowski in his Fifth Avenue penthouse apartment overlooking Manhattan's Central Park. It is here that Stokowski also attends to most of the orchestra's business affairs and presides over a full and busy personal life.
Dear Anshi, at last daylight, the Catholics are so slow and vague, I've given up hope of them, of doing it. I've given up hope of doing it in the, what you call this cathedral?
St. Patrick's.
In St. Patrick's Cathedral, which is central, has very good acoustics.
3689. Mr. Aaron.
Hello? No. It's not possible. I don't have time. Yes. I think you're right. And I think just the same way that you do. So I think then say to him you regret that it will not be possible because we have so many other things in between. Also, I want to think about what the place that has a bridge. A bridge from New York to Long Island Bridge. No. Famous bridge.
George Washington?
No. Brooklyn. How about Brooklyn? Either the Academy of Music or the other one. You are? Yes. All right. Then I'd like also to think about up the other way, North Westchester. Because it's in Westchester that I'm a farmer, and I would like to be a musician in Westchester as well as a farmer. All right? Thanks. Thank you. Bye.
St. Patrick's Cathedral, which is centrally located.
Has excellent acoustics, a wonderful organ and organist, and a fine chorus. This would be ideal, but they are so slow. I have decided to make the first performance in St. John the Divine, if you are willing.
Anxious to enter Stokowski's orchestra, and understandably nervous, a young violinist, Marilyn Dubow, arrives for an audition.
Day, if you could practice 1 hour and then do something else, then come back another hour, but you concentrate that hour, you concentrate this hour.
Yes.
Mentally you concentrate, especially left hand technique, especially bow technique. Then I would suggest you give half of that time to solo playing, like you did the Ives, and also Beethoven, violin, yes. And Bach, violin. May I see your violin?
Yes, sure.
Good. 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 Front plate's good everywhere. This is the maximum vibration just there. Right in that center. That's usually, this wood is usually thicker here than at the sides. They thin it out toward the edges. The good violin makers do. It's a very good instrument.
Thank you very much.
Yes. So study all those things, and just as soon as possible, we would like to have you with us in the orchestra.
Thank you very much,
for today. Yes,
thank
goodbye.
You.
Stokowski keeps to a tight daily schedule. He's now on his way to another part of Manhattan to be honored by the American Academy of Arts and Letters, the gold medal for distinguished service to the arts. Stokowski is to be the first conductor to receive the award. He is joined by philanthropist Samuel Rubin and Mrs. Rubin, patrons of the American Symphony Orchestra and close friends of Stokowski and his family.
Maestro, you have two young boys. How do they feel about today's world?
They see it the way most students do, in new ways. And we often, the three of us, have conversations, and they ask me questions, and I ask them questions, and we see how differently we see life. They have been brought up since they were very small. They've been going to our rehearsals and our concerts of the kind of music which we perform, the music of the great masters, from Bach down to Stravinsky today. And they are accustomed to that music, and they love it, and understand it, and react to it. But they also have their ideas about music, and they are quite different. And they have their own orchestra. It's not a big orchestra like the American Symphony Orchestra, which numbers sometimes as many as 110 players, but they have, their orchestra only numbers 5 players. Is this the right place?
We're here.
Are you sure? I see some broken windows.
Well, someone was here before us, that's why.
Some dissident conductors have been here.
It is the custom of these institutions.
Old traditions die hard, and the Academy still does not allow photography at its functions.
In our opinion, the world of the arts owes a very special debt for the support of its purposes and activities. For the presentation of this award, I'm going to turn the rostrum over to Mr. Virgil Thompson.
Boy, are we in good company today. And in the line of that, I have the honor, in the name of the Institute and Academy, to present to you Leopold Stokowski, no less.
We have a motto in the American Symphony Orchestra, which is, do better. And it would be a good motto for life all over the world today when we are killing instead of loving. Do better, world.
Funny story. And she said, yes, it will be.
A cocktail party for the guests of honor. In attendance are more literary celebrities than the average person is likely to meet in a lifetime. Yet Stokowski stays only a short while. Time is becoming more precious to him, and he does not waste a minute.
Together. No, that's not together. Together. The F's not together, the E flat's not together. Attention, you must listen more. We're in a strange acoustic here. It's different from Carnegie Hall. This is good and that's good, but it's different. Beginning, attack. You're dragging. Keep with the conductor, please. Number one. Shot. Light. Mm-hmm. all brass instruments, fortepiano. Mark it, please. Otherwise, we don't hear the violins. Please mark it. Mark it again. It's already marked, but mark it better. Right, that's number four. Brass is only, number four, brass. No, no, piano, piano. Down more. Down, that's it. Make like pianissimo, right? Four.
The best a composer can do when within him he hears in his soul a great melody, we'll say, is to put it on paper. But that paper, we call it music, but that's not music, that's only paper. It's blank marks on paper. Somehow, it's our privilege and our necessity to try to realize what was in the soul of the composer, in his inner hearing, and to make that alive again.
No, we're not together, cello bass. Watch conductor, please. You can memorize each bar. Number five.
Not merely blank marks on the white paper, but the expression and the creative ideas which the composer has. This is very difficult. Some believe that one should merely mechanically reproduce the marks on the paper. Others think that one must go much farther than that, to try to find what the composer heard in his soul. Because our duty is to give to the listeners that inspiration that the composer had.
Letter A, all brass instruments, fortepiano. Mark it, please. And a soft piano. Brass is, in this hall, it's better to play under. Play softer, quieter, easier. Letter A, yes. Do you have an alto trombone? Do you have one? Could we use it in this? I think it has another quality of tone. All right, A. Subito piano, everybody. That's careless. You know better. You're good players, you're good musicians, you're intelligent, and you can read. Do it, please, when it's forte piano. Please do it. 2 bars before eight. 1 first violin, still too strong on the F sharp. 2 bars, same.
Every summer, Stokowski travels to Europe. He dislikes flying, and for close to 60 years, he's been making regular trips by ocean liner. All told, Stokowski has probably spent the equivalent of 2 years of his life on the high seas.
Well, first of all, we're going to England, and there I have many records to make, because they do very good recording in England.
They do, yes.
The engineers are splendid there, and all the conditions are good. After that, I have concerts in Albert Hall in England, and after that we make some more records. After that, I go to Paris, to conduct the new orchestra. There's a new orchestra in France now called the Orchestre Paris. Very wonderful orchestra. I do rehearsals and concerts with them. And then I go to Germany to do television in, what's the name of the place? Saarbrücken. It's on the edge. After that, I go to Switzerland and then to Italy and then back to England to make more records there and more concerts.
How many records in all will you make records?
Six.
Six.
Not counting the television in Germany. Then I go back to New York to go on with the work with the American Symphony Orchestra in New York City. And that ends the tour. In between, I take some rest times and visit some friends.
Quite an active summer all in all.
Yes. That's funny.
Hoist of baggage coming up. I wonder if some of your trunks are in there.
I don't have
trunks. No, I have no trunks.
I only have valise suitcases. I like going to different countries and meeting different people. Because the important thing about life is people, men, women, and children. And in many places in the world today, the conditions are not good for children. So that is the big thing, people. Of course, in these European countries, the conditions are good, but in Africa are very many bad places in Africa, and also in Asia.
Asia, particularly.
In India, I've been twice to India. It's a wonderful country, but many people are starving there. And we have so much extra wheat in the United States, we could send it to them. I would like to see our government make more wheat, not less, but more, and give it away. Now I have a son coming, as you know, and I hope those girls will look out for him.
I will take good care of him.
Yes. He'll be on the same ship. Same
ship. Is that the 7th of July?
7th of July, yes. Wonderful boat, this. He's been on it before. He knows his ship. Because he travels every summer. Is this England?
Yes, sir.
This is England.
This is England?
Yes. It's not raining for a change.
It's just 5 minutes ago.
Beautiful weather. Wonderful ship going from a great ship into a great land.
Thank you, sir.
Passing through customs is never a difficult scene for Stokowski. His suitcases are usually crammed with dozens of painstakingly marked orchestral scores. All have been carefully studied by the maestro during the 5-day voyage.
Gary?
Yes?
Can we check the fiddle mics, please?
Yep.
Is that the first, 56?
Yes.
Thank you. Can we try the inner now?
Outside London, at Walthamstow, the recording engineers make last-minute tests of their equipment. Recording for stereo is a much more intricate technology than when Stokowski made his first recording way back in 1917. Even before the advent of the long-playing record, Stokowski educated himself about the latest engineering methods. In the years that followed, he experimented constantly to achieve the best in sound reproduction. Today, Stokowski probably knows as much about recording techniques as any conductor alive.
Good afternoon, Mike. Are you Heather?
Yes.
Are you the girl that has that sometimes a little coffee with
that's
a little, little bottle?
That's right.
Can we make this higher? Up to here.
Just. 4. Can you get that?
Yeah, fine, Gary, thanks.
5, there's the cellos.
Good. Now the horns over the far side.
Would you bring that black box over and Gary, please?
in the front here because this stand needs to sink from the hill up or down.
You gave me a roll like that. I use it every day.
You want another roll?
I have plenty
left.
Yeah, but it's very strong. And it really holds. Yes. Splendid.
How about those pencils I gave you? Were they any use? The blue one?
A blue pencil I use every day. I use it even this morning. Yeah.
Oh, good. Seems to write on anything, which is rather good.
Well, I use black, red, and blue.
56 next. Right. Chiba. Oh, right at the back. 64.
That's right?
Yes.
Good. How's that? So that's still high?
Just right.
That's a bit wobbly. I'll fix that.
Mr. D'Amato, may I speak with you? Where are the violas?
Cellos. Violas, second. First.
Cello. Violas are here then. First, seconds. Now on distant left, you have flute oboe. Yes. And all the brasses are here.
On the right with clarinet.
At the back. Let's make sure the horns are not too much amplified. Otherwise, it'll give me trouble later on when we transfer.
Between the two.
Yes.
All right. I need a peek from you, as you know.
Oh, we'll do that.
Autograph this for
him. Who's it for?
It's for one of the horn players.
Ask him to bring it himself.
I'll do that.
Number 13. Second moment. 13. Oboe. Ah, yes. Right on 13. Those short notes, they're marked piano. Mezzo forte. All woodwinds, all brasses. Letter B. Will you mark it piano, please? Please mark it. Please. Beethoven.
Leopold Stokowski was born in London on the 18th day of April, 1882, at number 13 Upper Marylebone Street, now known as New Cavendish Street. His father was a cabinet maker, and so was his grandfather, who had emigrated from Poland. Today, much of the old neighborhood remains as it was in those Victorian days, but on the site of Stokowski's birthplace now stands an office building. Soon after, the family moved to the Cashew Road in St. John's Wood, a sedate, elegant residential section of London. Many of the city's leading literary figures, like the Huxleys and novelist D.H. Lawrence, used to live there.
Pick them up higher. We'll bring them down later. It's violas and cellos. All set, maestro.
Even among precocious children, the young Stokowski was exceptional. He was only 14 years of age when in 1896 he was admitted to the Royal College of Music. Stokowski was the youngest student ever accepted. The usual age was 17. That same year, a new Royal College of Music was completed. The opening ceremony was attended by the patron of the college, the Prince of Wales. How long ago it all seems. Giuseppe Verdi was still alive, so was Brahms and Bruckner and Johann Strauss. Two inventions that Stokowski would eventually turn to his own uses, the phonograph and the movie camera, were in their infancies. In the generation since, the Royal College has changed little. The young Stokowski spent most of his studying days in room 83. From the window of this room, he had a full view of the Royal Albert Hall. Stokowski was already ambitious, but could he have realized that one day he would be conducting in that same Albert Hall? It was on this pipe organ that Stokowski took his first lessons from Dr. Stevenson Hoyt. Another important teacher was Dr. Henry Walford Davies, organist and choir master at Temple Church.
Do you know the timing on the last movement?
No, unfortunately.
Couldn't you combine them?
Yes, we will do that when we play it, master.
That's your coffee. You want on a stool to your right?
Yes, just there, please. Thank you.
I think we'll have to do this with a break after the second movement. I think we need time to change tapes. I don't want that to happen again.
Yes.
Right.
Well, when you're going to change tapes, always call me quickly.
Yeah.
Because otherwise...
No, I thought I had enough.
We lose
I thought
time.
I had about 35 minutes of tape.
What's the full length of the last?
Full length is 1452.
1452?
Yeah.
What is the whole thing then?
3219.
3219?
Yeah.
You can do it?
Yep.
Is this Decca? That's a Decca pencil. Look at that.
That's great. That's where we make money, Master.
Yes, that's right. Yes. Oh, here are some good pencils here. They're not Decca. These are London Records.
Stokowski's first important job came in 1902, when he was appointed organist and choir master at St. James Church, Piccadilly. Two women who knew him reminisce about those early days.
One of the first things I remember about him was being allowed to stay to listen to the voluntary. He played Bach's Toccata and Fugue, and I was so, well, chattered. I think it started all the music in me that could possibly... I can't express myself. It was just too wonderful for words.
My husband was in the choir as a boy. He was a solo boy. He had a lovely voice, my husband, a boy. And he used to sing all the solos in church for him. And then they used to come out after the service, and the choir, the whole choir, used to sing outside here. And he'd bring his orchestra out and have it conduct out here. And of course, he used to get a crowd around here watching him, you see. He was very, very fair. And,
yes, he really was good looking.
Very good looking, handsome, really. Well, no, he was good looking. Very
frightfully
nice looking.
Good looking.
Oh, well, I remember when he used to take the choir boys out cycling Saturday afternoons, and they'd all go down Piccadilly, and I remember I was crossing Piccadilly one day, and I saw Mr. Stokowski in front of all. He'd got the choir boys there with him, because my husband was there. He was only a boy then, and so we knew each other. And I looked for him, and I saw him there as well, and they were all going cycling down Piccadilly. And, oh, they enjoyed it very much. They loved going out with him Saturday afternoon. He gave up all his Saturday afternoons to them.
He used to come to our house and have lunch nearly every Sunday because it saved him. Well, we were only in Duke Street, and he just, well, was part of our family. And my mother adored him. She really, well, we all did, but mother especially. She had a very soft spot in her heart for him. Her dear boy, as she called him.
In 1905, Stokowski accepted an offer to go to America to become organist and choir master at St. Bartholomew's Church in New York. Before leaving for New York, he wrote the following note to Henry Walford Davies. Dear Doctor, I'm going to America. I owe you nearly everything. Can I see you before I go? I should so like to. In great haste, your grateful Stowe. In 1909, Stokowski took over the reins of the Cincinnati Symphony. It was his first orchestra job, and he was then still conducting with a baton instead of the now famous Stokowski hands. In October 1912, Stokowski moved to the Philadelphia Orchestra. It was here, in the Academy of Music, that he began one of the great conducting careers of the 20th century. He was just 30 years old and was about to introduce to America a new kind of personalized conducting, setting a style to prevail for many years. He had new ideas about music. He presented the works of contemporary composers such as Debussy, Sibelius, Schoenberg, and Rachmaninoff, all of whom were alive and flourishing at that time. It was Stokowski who led the first American performance of Stravinsky's Rite of Spring and Mahler's monumental Symphony No. 8 with a cast of over 1,000 singers and players. He had new ideas about what an orchestra should sound like. Sound, that was the key word. To Stokowski, this was everything. Soon, the Philadelphia Orchestra began to sound as though it were made up of 100 or more individual virtuosos. And people began to realize that Stokowski had turned it into one of the world's greatest orchestras. He also had new ideas about glamour and image. The hall was redecorated in blue and gold. He brought more publicity to the role of classical conducting than anyone ever had before. By the time he resigned from Philadelphia in 1938, He was an international celebrity, honored and decorated by governments all over the world. Despite the pace of Stokowski's phenomenal career, he took time out to experiment with Hollywood. He was starred in films like 100 Men and a Girl,
Stokowski.
How did you manage to come in here? How do you get into places where you should not be?
I don't know. My daddy says it's a gift.
I'm sorry, but you must leave now. Do you realize how much trouble you've given me?
Oh, I didn't mean to, really. You see, what really happened...
Yes, but why did you do it? You must have had a reason.
Yes, I had a reason. I had 100 reasons. Would you like to hear them?
I certainly would.
He also collaborated with Walt Disney on the film Fantasia. Stokowski became a United States citizen in 1915.
Let's go, ASO! Let's go, ASO! Let's go, ASO!
The American way of doing things obviously appealed to him then, and still does.
I have a band. I have a new idea. All the trumpets in the orchestra play violin, and the violins play trumpet. Everybody plays the wrong instrument.
I think
it would be horrible.
It'll be great. It'll be great.
Let's go, Johnny Bibby. Hey, Johnny boy.
Well, you know that for the benefit, we're thinking of auctioning off the right to lead the orchestra. We're going to have an auction, and the person who wins it will have the right to lead the orchestra for 5 minutes during a rehearsal.
No, really?
Wouldn't that be amusing?
I don't know.
Every spring, his orchestra assembles in New York Central Park for a baseball game against the New York Philharmonic, and his orchestra always seems to win.
I heard the ball hit the ground. What are you telling me?
I heard you went tonight in the
front lodge.
Spanish music.
Right.
Great concert.
Yeah. Really. How was the tambourine, maestro?
I saw that it could have been just a little bit louder. But seriously, I think the percussion section, your percussion section, is very great. But I think there's no limit to how percussions could be developed.
Right.
Subtlety. Particularly pianissimo. Wonderful pianissimo.
Can you explain to them what that means, pianissimo?
One of the players is Stokowski's son, Christopher, whose mother is Gloria Vanderbilt, the third of Stokowski's ex-wives.
Kill!
My voice! He's lost his voice. He can't sing.
Very good.
Thank you so much for the game. Next year. Yes. Now listen, Philharmonic, do a little work. Yes. Practice your instrument. We will. We must do better. Yes, with this.
Stokowski is visited by the Canadian pianist Glenn Gould. Here, he interviews Stokowski for a radio feature he is producing for the Canadian Broadcasting Corporation.
What would you like to do?
Well, I'm really at your disposal. I would like to ask some rather dopey-sounding, very wide-open questions, which are in no way specific.
Oh, we're going to talk together, is that it?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
You're going to ask me questions? Yes. Yeah. Would you like to tell me the questions now, then I can begin to think? I'm a little slow.
Another thing that we can do, we can just sort of discuss one area at a time and stop tape and then talk about it a bit. And if we think of something else we'd like to say, go back and do it again.
Right.
That's a very flexible way to
get. What's the first one?
Maestro, I have a recurring dream in which I dream myself into a situation where I'm the first known being on another planet. If you were, by some technological miracle, able to go tomorrow to a planet within the solar system where they had thinking creatures who had at the same time never experienced art, and you were the first artist there, and you were told, go ahead, you may create an artistic system for them, A, would you want to do it? B, what would you do?
You speak of a solar system. I have the impression that there are many solar systems, that ours is a very big one, but there are others which are much larger, and still others which again are larger. I have also the impression that not only is there endless space and endless mass of the solar systems that are in that space, but there's endless time, and there is endless mental power, like what is in a small sense in our minds, in this little earth we live on, that there are greater masses of mind, of which ours is only a small part. So I would do my best to give a clear impression to what other form of life there might be on that planet, of what I think is beautiful and orderly, what I think is creative, and what I think is destructive. And it would be possible, I hope, to let them see what's happening on this earth so much destruction and so little compared with that destruction that is creative, because many minds who are in what we call war, destruction, those minds might have enormous creative power.
Mr. McLuhan would have it that sooner or later there will be no composers, there will be no artists as separate individuals, that we will all be part of one feedback process, that the whole idea of the artist is...
Who has this idea?
Professor McLuhan.
Who is Professor McLuhan?
Well, he's a rather fascinating gentleman who lives in Canada but is a bit of a gadfly. He's all over the world now.
Yes. Well, he has a right to his opinion. I think exactly the opposite. And I have the right to my opinion, too. He lives in Canada and I live in the United States. He travels much in the world. I travel much in the world. So at least we're together as travelers. But otherwise, I disagree entirely with what he said. But what makes him think that?
He thinks that we are returning to a pre-Renaissance attitude, an attitude that existed in the days before print culture, before books were widely distributed. He thinks that we're getting back into a kind of oral space. In which
what makes him think that there were no poets and no artists before a certain period? There have always been persons on this earth, and just as today some love beauty and order, it is quite possible that the so-called caveman had such ideas too, on his level, in his way, according to his idea of the best life of that time. We do not know how the caveman, at least I do not know how the caveman felt about life, but I doubt if Professor, what is his name, McLuhan? I doubt if he knows that either. 2:20. What's that, D? Tenuto. Camera. Camera. Start with camera. Three deaths. Then more come in. Ad libitum. You know when to come in by instinct. Presto. Presto. Come on, more, come on, feel it. Presto. Now begin, come on.
There never has been anyone quite like Leopold Stokowski. For years, he has been seen and heard by millions of concertgoers. For years, he has championed modern music, improved standards of orchestral playing, and kept music glamorous and exciting. At 88, he is less flamboyant, less theatrical than in years gone by, but he still has the old Stokowski gift for keeping busy and planning for the future. He still has the old master's touch. Even in the twilight of his career, there is a certain Olympian magnificence about Leopold Stokowski.
Thank you. Tomorrow. Next rehearsal. When is next rehearsal?
Monday.
Monday. What time? 3 o'clock Monday here. Goodbye.
Van out the loop tomorrow morning, 10 o'clock. Van out the loop tomorrow morning, 10 o'clock for those involved. Otherwise, Monday, 3 o'clock here.
This is PBS, the Public Broadcasting Service.